This is RSBANDB Update, episode 554, recorded Thursday, February 18th, 2016, Decrypting Nomad's Elegy. Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us for RSBANDB Update. Sitting in with Colton and myself this week is Duke Juker, former Informer writer. Hello.
Hello.
And Colton, how are you doing this week?
I am doing lovely, as always. Thank you very much.
Excellent. It feels like you and I just talked, but we'll get into that a bit later, won't we?
Yes.
Alrighty, so Duke is here because he is an up-and-coming quester. You just really got interested in quests over Christmas break, I think, right?
Well, I was always interested in quests. I just never had the willpower to go and just finish them all. And the other thing I really wanted to do was I wanted to finish the quests in release date order, just because I kind of wanted to like experience them like in the order they came out, so I didn't miss any of the lore. And like, you know, for example, playing World Wakes, I'd, you know, be caught up and know everything that's going on. So I just got really interested in it and caught up over Christmas and January and ended up getting my quest cape. So this is the first time I've had to do a quest to keep my cape.
Excellent. So this week's quest is, of course, Nomad's Elegy, the first in the, I think, four-part series that's called Sliskay's Countdown. I think it's going to be four quests, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
So basically, this quest requires that you have 75 woodcutting, mining, and construction. You must have also completed Dishonor Among Thieves, The Mighty Fall, The Void Stares Back, Nomad's Requiem, Throne of Miscellanea, and Heart of Stone. It's also recommended but not required to have completed Blood Runs Deep and Walgothic Sleeps. And the reason for that is that both Blood Runs Deep and Walgothic Sleeps are 5th Age quests. Well, of course, we're in the 6th Age right now. Mm-hmm. So, Nomad's Elegy. Before we begin, what were we thinking going into this? Let's start with you, Duke.
Well, I mean, obviously from the name, I thought it'd have something to do with Nomad either dying or, you know, we'd be lamenting something about Nomad. I mean, it's not exactly the most likable character in the game, but you know, even villains get to have their respects paid to them once they're gone. So I was kind of expecting something akin to what happened.
All right, and Colton.
Well, I mean, obviously, we this kind of follows up from the events that we saw with Dishonor Among Thieves, being that either we let Nomad grab a hold of a piece of the Stone of Jazz, or we sort of sent him on his merry way without a piece. So he revealed in that quest, as I've said earlier, that that he is basically seeking out power for himself and kind of going rogue, as it were. He's not aligning with any particular god, and so it's a little bit interesting to see what he does in order to sort of climb the ladder of power.
Right. Okay. So let's go through a bit of an overview of this quest right now. Colton, would you want to take us through this?
Oh, yeah, sure. So basically you start out the quest by going to Soul Wars. You see Zimberfizz there as he is taking care of Soul Wars, as he always is. And basically he says that there is something going wrong with the soul obelisk that is under Nomad's old tent in his temple. So you both go down there and you investigate some things. You get to the fourth object that you investigate out of a possible five that kind of tricks you into thinking that you can eventually get to a fifth clue, but there is no fifth clue, spoilers. And suddenly you sort of trigger an explosion of sorts. You die, quote unquote, but it's not a normal death. This takes you to death's office, as you normally would if you die, but you get sort of a cinematic pan of the camera that you get to see into death's office, that he is speaking with King Ichi, Ikhlorin.
Yeah.
Yes. And they are discussing the fact that Nomad has been once again doing his power grab stuff and has overtaken Ikhlorin's fortress in the underworld. And you need to help them reclaim this area for them, because obviously it's not a good thing. Ikhlorin's job is to ferry souls into the afterlife. And if he's not able to do that, that's kind of a bad thing. So we then go through Death's Door and enter the underworld.
Oh, hang on. We got to point out the pile of ashes that were on the floor in Death's office.
Where exactly was it in Death's office?
It was right in front of the desk.
Okay. Man, I just was not observing.
I didn't notice that either.
Yeah, apparently poor Zimberfizz in our explosive experience is ousted by the blast and is not remade like we are every time we die. So he kind of just
does what an imp does and becomes a pile of ashes.
Yeah, very true. Does it look like a normal pile of ashes?
No, it's different.
Oh, okay. So he's at least a special pile of ashes. He got his own model for his own ashes. So that's a nice tribute to Zimberfizz, but interesting. Anyhow, we then travel to the underworld, which many would recognize as it is was the location of the last Halloween event. And basically you're told that you need to gather adventurers from the afterlife in order to sort of rally to the cause and to help fight back against Nomad. And so you can go either, there are two different afterlives you get to go to. And the first one that I went to was personally the Dusty Jetty, which was the one that took you to a sort of a limbo of sorts that is an alternate dimension of Lumbridge.
Yeah.
And so going here, you're greeted by your spouse from Throne of Miscellanea, which is either Astrid, if you're a male character, or it starts with a B. I can't remember. Huh?
Brand. I think it's Brand.
Yeah, Brand.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. And basically you're like, oh, hello, and you greet your dearly beloved that you you knew for about 20 minutes during that quest before you married them, and very soon after they died. But regardless, deep romance, still better than Twilight. Basically, they greet you, tell you that you need to go find some adventurers. There will be three. And you go around, you find Xenia, you find Hazelmere, and depending on your choices during the Void Knight quests, either Karasi or Jessica is the one you killed. So you have to save one of those two. And basically what the goal is especially for Xenia and Jessica Karasi, you sort of your job is to collect their memory and to sort of piece it back together so that they can remember who they are. Hazelmere has that same problem too, but his is a bit strange because you don't, with Jessica slash Karasi and Xenia, basically you go around and you find their halves of consciousness or whatever you want to call them, and you kind of put them together and it brings them back to their normal selves. Whereas Hazelmere is having he's having trouble like staying in one place and can't really determine where he is, who he is. And so you kind of,
time displacement issue.
Yeah, yeah. It's like a temporal distortion or something like that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so you basically you just bring these guys back to where they can remember who they are and their purpose, and you recruit them to your cause. I thought it was a fairly enjoyable process. It was, especially with Hazelmere, because he's been one of my favorite characters for quite a while. You guys have any thoughts on this part?
You know, I was surprised when you went up top there and you opened up that chest and that thing jumped out at you. I thought I wasn't exactly ready for combat at that point, but luckily it wasn't too bad.
Yeah, you open. Do you have to open two chests for Xenia stuff?
Yeah, and the first one jumps out at you.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And it's like... It's really simple combat. If you take much damage, then I don't know, you must be doing something wrong. No, it wasn't difficult. It was just a bit of a, oh, okay, we're doing combat already. Because
yeah,
it's like,
yeah.
When you think Nomad Quest, you're
kind of
ready.
Yeah, you're kind of expecting it. One thing that really made me laugh was Hazelmere's mention of non-Euclidean planes.
Yeah.
Oh, that was so great because, you know, he is split apart, you know, in that he's teleporting around. So hence, he is outside of what would be a standard Euclidean reality. And that's, you know, our current kind of coordinate system, you know, where we have an X and a Y or a latitude and a longitude.
Mm-hmm. But, from here.
Yes, it was a good part of the quest. I liked, I just like seeing old faces. Like, basically, yeah. These characters get removed from the game, and you feel like, oh my god, I'll never see them again. But then they show up, and you're like, wow, this is really good. And you can kind of like extrapolate, like with Xenia, for example, you can like ask her, like, what the heck were you thinking when you like were trying to wake up the Elder Gods? And she just kind of like explains and understands like the mistake she made. And, yeah, I mean, it's always nice to have that aspect where you bring a character back and you can kind of like work with them again, even if it's not exactly while they're still alive.
And Colton, yeah, weren't you happy that she was dead?
I honestly didn't care. And this is what I was going to ask Duke about, is that I am kind of anti-signature hero, especially like Xenia. I feel like her death was just a death to have a death. It seemed really pointless, and I did not care one way or another if she died or not in that quest. I think it was Heart of Stone. What are your feelings regarding Xenia and the other signature heroes, Duke, being one who recently did a lot of the quests?
Yeah. Well, I remember when I played that quest, that was kind of like pitting you between Xenia and... who's the other signature? Ariane, right?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And I really, like, one, I didn't like having to choose sides because I was kind of like, well, like, it's not like she's really doing the wrong thing. It's just she doesn't understand the consequences of what she's going to do. But, yeah, like, it wasn't really clear from the quest that she had died. She kind of just, like, flies back into this portal, like, thingy. It's just kind of like, well, did she go to a different dimension or, like, what happened? No, she died for sure. So that's kind of like figured out, but I didn't really feel bad about it. I was just kind of like, you know, well, maybe she should have listened to us and not just done her own thing. Like she just kind of like Nomad, just kind of lost her mind and just ignored the warning signs and just didn't consider the consequences. And so I couldn't really feel bad for her character. And even now I'm just kind of like, well, now you're dead and you knew what you did wrong. So I guess it is what it is.
Yeah. Moving on from this location, we gather these guys up, and as we're about to go back to the River Numenon, Nomad comes in and brutally murders our beloved right in front of our eyes, which is horrifying, I guess.
It wasn't horrifying.
No.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was kind of a joke, like, because the character really didn't react much in terms of dialogue, in terms of facial expression.
But how can you murder someone who's already dead?
That's the thing. And it's I took it as he like took her very soul, and that obviously if
well that would fit in the general gist of this quest.
Yeah, I mean that's kind of what Nomad does, and so one would if you believe in the afterlife and those sorts of things, if believing that your loved one has now been taken away from the ability to have a fulfilling afterlife, I think that would be a considerably upsetting thing. But our character does not seem to be fairly fussed about it. And I don't know if they were trying to make a joke of it, like, oh, we know it's silly that we had you marry this character and there's obviously no actual like love connection, so we're just gonna have your character do a complete non-response to this. I'm wondering if that was their aim with this, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I kind of question sometimes the choices they have you make. Just like, do I actually really care about this choice? Like, some are really important, but like others are just like, well, it's not like I really like this character anyway. So
yeah.
No, and love lost.
I mean, when you think about it, Throne of Miscellanea so long ago, and the fact that you have an RS wedding centered around that, I mean, it's not exactly something that was meant to be taken seriously when you're doing Throne of Miscellanea. Because who would have thought that Throne of Miscellanea, all these years later, would factor into a quest that is dealing with someone's potential ascension to godhood?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Although, didn't you have a choice not to marry your person?
I don't know.
I think you had, because I think technically in Throne, you just give them like a gift and then you're like on good terms. And then it's not until the V quest where you like meet up with them again, and then the king and the queen get married on the boat. And then your person's like, hey, we should get married too. And then it like gives you the choice. And I was like, no, not right now. And then she like cries. And I was just like, no.
Huh.
Sorry.
See, I don't. Yeah. It's just been so long that it's kind of fuzzy for me personally. So that's interesting.
Very interesting perspective.
Yeah. If it was an option not to marry, I guess it would kind of lend more credence to the fact that it's like, oh, the character really doesn't care. It's not a big deal.
I mean, some of these choices you make, like, you never even remember them. And it's like, you get to this point, you're like, did I actually marry this person? Did I actually like this person? And you're just kind of stuck kind of trying to figure out what your actual relationship was to that person. Then you have to make a decision about it.
Yeah, it's interesting. But,
all right.
Anyhow.
On to the Bandos afterlife?
Yes. And that's when you move on to the other jetty, and it's the Bloody Jetty. This takes you to sort of a purgatory of sorts, which is of Zanuck's own making, I think. Basically, she's kind of going through this internal struggle where she's just conflicted about all the things she's done with regards to the cave goblins and her interactions with all the Bandosians and everything like that. And so basically, she's trying and failing to protect her cave goblin brethren from the threats of Bandosian followers that would seek to kill them. And so the player comes in trying to recruit Zanuck, but she's like, no, I have to do this thing here. And let me do this thing and help me if you can.
But critical thing here for anyone who doesn't realize this, but this means that after Zanuck initially returned to Ubisec after the Mighty Fall, that she did pass away.
Yeah, regardless of your choice. Because you could choose to spare her or kill her again. Like,
yes.
That was a choice you could make. And it was like, oh, I spared her. And then I ran into her and it's like, oh, well, you're actually dead. So,
and I think that was sort of the implication in Mighty Fall, because she said she was like, basically, I'm terminally ill.
Yeah.
And so it's like, either you send me to Ubisec and I die leading the Bandosians to some new future, or you just let me die, and that sort of thing. So that was the early death or a different kind of death. But regardless, mm-hmm. she died at some point.
Yeah.
And
I think this part of the quest we're coming up to is one that people found annoying or tedious, let's say.
Yeah.
It took me, I think it was either two or three tries to get it done. First try, I had no idea what was going on, trying to, you know, prevent the goblins from being slaughtered. Second try, I realized it, and then, I'm done, so I can relax it a bit, but no. And then finally, third try, I got everything done. But in essence, it's a three-way fight where you need to prevent the goblin forces from killing Zanny's cave goblins. So,
yeah, and it's really just and the easiest way to make these waves go by is to use ice spells from the Ancient Magics spellbook. But if you don't, it's very doable with ranged or just regular magics if you don't have access to ancients or the levels required. And basically, you just have to tag all the creatures that are trying to kill the cave goblins.
Yeah, basically draw the aggro of them and keep mm-hmm. them on you rather than going in.
Which isn't quite as easy as most characters,
yeah.
because some of them, I feel, like, were insistent on just going
Did
in regardless.
Did you see how quick they ran?
Oh, yeah. Some of them absolutely sprinted for the guy, which... I thought that run speeds were not a thing that Jagex could really alter, at least with player characters.
Well, it's
maybe
an NPC, so,
yeah.
I mean...
I guess that's true.
I think they were going the fastest run speed. It just seemed like it was quicker. Like, you know, you don't realize how fast you're actually running until you, like, see other people running, so...
Yeah, I guess that's true. That makes sense.
Another thing I was thinking that you could try, I didn't try it at the time, but what about the provoke ability?
Provoke, it only deals with, well, maybe that would have worked if you had them already in combat, if you were already in mm-hmm. combat with that NPC, not NBC, not National Broadcasting Company.
Yeah, and again, when I was looking at the Reddit, I saw a lot of people suggest that, like, if you wanted to, you know, go melee or something like that, you could use provoke and you could do it. And probably, again, not easily, but it's still possible.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't try that. I didn't even think of ice spells. I just used my noxious
yeah.
bow.
Basically, what I did is I created a choke point at the bridge. Then I just casted that group ice spell right there. I also used some area of effect abilities. The only two that are in the magic book, which, I mean, it's kind of disappointing that there's only two area of effect abilities for dual wielding magic, but that's a topic for another day. And aside from that, just make sure that you keep icing them.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, you don't even need barrage for that. You can use the level 70 spell blitz, I believe it is.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think at this point, everyone who will have been doing this quest has probably done Desert Treasure and has access to at least one of the ice spells.
Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure Desert Treasure is a requirement for Wal'Gothic Sleep. Oh, wait, but Wal'Gothic
That's not
Sleep
a requirement.
Ended, yeah. Okay.
And it's Ice Burst, by the way. I just looked that up. I was confused, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ice Blitz is the narrow, the bolt.
It's the 82 one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, you basically fight three waves of these guys, and if you let all of the cave goblins die on any particular wave, it will reset you, but only from that wave. And it will replenish your number of cave goblins all the way back to 10. So it's really not that bad.
Yeah, and I found it very accommodating in that regard, too. Mm-hmm. Everything they did combat-wise in this quest.
Yeah, it wasn't... Because most quests, especially older quests, it's... You have to start from the very beginning, and there's no mercy with regards to those sorts of mechanics. But here, it's like not only does it start you back from the phase that you failed on, but it also gives you possibly more cave goblins than you began that wave with. So it's really not too bad. This maybe it'll take a few tries just to get a hang of kind of spam aggroing these guys, but after a few tries it should be doable for anyone who has the necessary requirements for these quests.
So. Yeah, and I mean, these are safe deaths too, so the only thing you're expending in the afterlife is your runes.
Well, yeah, runes in time. And so basically, after the third wave, you're able to convince Zanuck that she's actually not, she doesn't need to do this. Like, she's punishing herself, really, for what she's done. And so you then take her away from Ubiusk, and you all unite in the underworld. And no, you don't do the speech yet. This, you interrogate Legio Septimus, who is a member
seventh
of
Legion of the Order, yes, of Ascension.
Mm-hmm. And they have sort of split off from the regular Order of Ascension as they are no longer representative of what he feels are the true values of holiness or whatever, what have you.
And they basically describe them as a religious cult at this point.
Essentially. It's the true order of the Ascension or something of that nature. And they're allied with Nomad to fulfill their goals. And basically, you're just interrogating this guy in order to get information about what we need to do with Nomad and with regards to his hiding out and what he's done to Ictharin's fortress that we might have to watch out for. And I talked about this yesterday, but this was extremely unintuitive in my opinion.
Yeah, and I mean, you can ask him so many things, but the question is, like, what do you actually, you know, need to ask him? And it turns out all you need to do is say, how do I defeat Nomad? That's the only thing you need to get out of him. You can get more out of him, too. I also got out of him that there's a shortcut that you can take to bypass part of the fight and what his plans were, rather than waiting until the end. So I did manage to get that out of him.
Yeah.
Now,
what did you feel about that, Duke?
Yeah, I didn't think it was a very interesting part of the quest. It was just kind of like, you know, you're just trying to get information from this guy and you basically spam options. And not, you know, super interesting, but it's, I mean, it just kind of like is a filler piece for, you know, going on to the next section. So, I mean, you got to do what you got to do.
Yeah, and I mean, you can do things along the way. He's got three stats that you can do. Health, willpower, and
sanity.
Mm-hmm. Right, so what you can do is you can do various actions and that will lower the three of them. And what I essentially did was I used my companions that were there with me to lower the sanity and willpower, and then I just, you know, kept removing the crystals until he was almost dead, basically beat him to a pulp, and then after that you know, let him recover for a bit and he talked.
I don't think I had the option to remove crystals. The most aggressive option I had in my two lists of options was threaten.
Yeah, the remove crystals appeared after threatening him a good number of times.
Oh, okay.
Just got to be a little more aggressive, Colton.
Yeah, I threatened like once, and then I restarted it and just did the whatever the nicer options were, where it was like, because soothe ended up being an option after you comforted him.
Wow.
For like a while. Yeah. And so it was like, whatever. So I took the more pacifist route.
You're developing a bit of Stockholm syndrome there.
I guess. Yeah. I mean, became good friends, you know, good acquaintances. Yeah, it was a little strange. I felt like there wasn't, and I guess it's funny because as someone who loves old quests, a lot of what a lot of people like about older quests, like Wild Gothic Sleeps and things like that, is that there's a lack of direction and a lack of hand-holding. But I feel like if this complaining about lack of direction is a little more warranted, because we have no, like, the amount of interrogation that we've done before is small, if any. and this was a completely different interface. We're not familiar with anything that's going on. We just don't know what we're supposed to do.
Yeah, it wasn't intuitive at all.
No. Mm-hmm. So there's a line between being hand-holdy and being intuitive, and I feel like this kind of this did neither. So
yeah,
it's kind of like that one, if you remember, I think it was while Guthic Sleep, where you have to like make the choices and then balance it out so it's not like over 50% in each category.
See, I thought that was even I thought that was a lot easier, because if you know Guthix is a god of balance, then you want to keep things balanced. And I felt like that was, you actually had a clue there, whereas there's really no benefit to being more aggressive or being more passive. There's no dialogue, there's nothing. You just go for the sake of doing it. And I don't know, it just seemed like it was strange.
And there's also the issue that sometimes when you pressed an interrogation option, not every time it reflected a change in the statistics of of the Legion.
Yes, I'd totally forgotten about that. But yeah, it was variable as to whether a threat or a compliment or whatever they were would actually do anything to his stats. It might do it like 1 out of 3 times, and so you just end up having to spam certain options to try and get him to break, really. Which, I mean, maybe that's more realistic, I don't know. But
I've never interrogated anyone.
Neither have I. I'm not a hardened interrogator in real life, but
I'd probably give up everything after the first question.
That's good to know.
Just ask him. That's all you need.
Oh, you're a softy, Shane. I'm not worried about you.
Oh. I'll have to wait and see about that then, won't we?
I guess so.
Anyhow, anything you guys have to say more about this Legio Septimus part?
No, not really. It seemed like, was he the only way of getting the information? Or could they have come up with a better way?
I don't know.
Maybe you could come up with something, but they probably just thought this was the easiest thing
to
do.
Like, where did he even come from? It's not like we had to capture him or anything.
Yeah, it's true. Who got him?
Because we get out of the afterlives, and there he is, ready to be tortured.
Yeah, he's just kind of shown up. And heck, those things put up a fight if you actually fight them down in the Ascension Dungeon, so... Man, if it was Death who went and got him, Death is a pro PVMer, you know. So it was all right. It just kind of felt awkward,
kind of iffy. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
What
about
the dialogue?
Was
cool.
Next battering ram part.
Yeah, you want to talk about that then?
Yeah. Okay. Well, obviously you're on the bridge that goes over the river Numion. And you need to penetrate into Nomad's fortress. And in order to do that, well, you need a battering ram. So you get a good boatload of construction XP. But of course, before you build this, you need rocks. And of course, you need wood. So you need to choose two adventurers to come and help you gather the wood. Well, you stand watch. You can help them, of course, if you want to as well. I did. It goes a bit faster. I chose Xenia and Hazelmere for that. How about you guys?
I chose the same two. And actually, I think you can have one of them keep watch and you like take on mining or wood cutting, and then you can, after you've finished, can help them out.
But there's nothing really to keep watch over.
No, there isn't. That's the thing.
I think I went with Zanuck and Hazelmere.
That's interesting. I didn't put Zanuck in there because I thought, okay, Zanuck isn't exactly, you know, the strongest here in case there's some kind of combat issue that comes up, so.
True, but she is, like, a miner, gatherer, cave goblin. I just thought, maybe that might be more useful.
Yeah, I guess that works. All right. I should have tracked how much construction XP we got because, actually I can do that based on yesterday's high score grab at highscores.rsbnb.com, because in addition to the reward, I can just do a quick subtraction there. So let's see. That's weird. It's not showing up. I thought I used my construction lamp. Oh, that's because I did the quest the day before. That's why. Sorry about that. Huh. Okay, apparently I only got 50k construction XP from that. Unless it was the day before.
No, that sounds about right. It wasn't crazy, it was just nice. I mean, any
25k construction XP, I think.
Yeah, any construction's good experience.
Right, because the quest was done over 2 days, because I did it after our high scores reset is when I completed it and got the lap, so that makes sense why it's fragmented like that. So about 25k construction XP for building this battering ram. Fun little thing, I don't know if you guys play with the music on, but the track that played during this was called Ram Upgrade, with the words capital R-A-M, so kind of an inside little joke there about computer ram. Did you guys catch that?
No, I play with my music on, but
yeah, same here. Usually I don't look at the, you know, pop up and say, oh, okay, that's an interesting title for a song.
So let's do a ram upgrade, and then after that you basically take the battering ram across the bridge while fighting off various waves of ascension creatures. Not too much to write home about here. They're basically the lower level things that you would encounter in the Ascension dungeon, so nothing too frightening. And then you break in, and you have a choice. You can use a shortcut if you discovered it in your interrogation, or you have to fight the next wave. Colton and Duke, did you guys have the shortcut discovered?
I did, but I didn't take it because I totally did not see it.
Okay.
Yeah, kind of same here. I just wanted to, like, I don't know, I felt like I'd miss out on something if I took the shortcut, so.
How much longer was the combat wave after that?
A significant amount.
Oh, boy.
I don't know, the, how long did it take you, Duke?
Oh, I don't know. It took me a little while.
It was a few minutes. Now that I think about it, it was maybe like 5, 5, 10, maybe maximum, topside,
I
remember. But well, it's just a lot more ascension creatures.
Yeah, and I mean, that's a substantial shortcut to take. So, I mean, if you can, you might as well if you're not a combat type. So that's what we have looking forward for anyone.
I mean, again,
quest.
Having like lesser stats, it might take you a little bit longer to get through stuff like that. So.
By the way, what did you use, Duke, for your combat method throughout the quest?
I kind of bounced around. I mean, like, on the Bandosian part, like, the first two waves, I did melee, and then the third wave, I did, like, well, basically tried everything. I tried mage and melee, and then on the next parts, usually I like to try melee first, because I'm just more comfortable with it, but if not, I usually go mage instead.
All right. And then, after this wave and moving through the shortcut, you end up fighting Nomad, the part that everyone was waiting for in this quest.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. Were you guys waiting for the Nomad fight?
Apprehensive.
With knees shaking.
Your knees were shaking.
Yeah, like someone who's scared.
Well, I mean, I know that, but wow, I've never had that kind of experience with RuneScape.
Maybe I'm being hyperbolic.
Okay. Well.
But I mean, they hyped it up. They hyped this fight up pretty hard. I mean, 300% Araxor is a difficult fight. I mean, you're constantly clicking places, and damage is a definite concern. Most of it is unavoidable, and a one-hit KO is just around the corner at just about every single part of the fight, whether it be a cleave or an exploding spider. The Nomad was not easy, but I would not say 300% Araxor hard.
Yeah.
You basically fight him. He's in four phases, and each phase you get kind of broken up. by taking control of one of your characters, being Xenia, Death, and Ixalan, respectively, between the first, second, third, and third, fourth phases.
Uh-huh.
And but the so you enter and you find that Nomad has sort of constructed his own god, as it were, being called Gielinor, and it sort of represents the entire planet, and everything is supposed to, like, I don't know, fight for them.
Yeah, and I mean, the logic is that it's built from the souls of everyone who dies on RuneScape, and hence why it's going to be the god of RuneScape, and it's going to fight for, well, supposedly the best outcome for the residents of Gielinor. But of course, its master is going to be Nomad.
Uh-huh.
So.
And so you're fighting Nomad, but at the same time you're also kind of fighting Gielinor. Well, at least you're trying to stay away from Gielinor, because during the fight, Nomad will teleport you to the center of a bridge and will basically say something along the lines of "Witness the power of Gielinor," and the big construct below you will, like, grab over the bridge and smack down, and if you don't move, it hits you pretty heavy. It's not a one hit KO. I want to say it's like 6k ish. It's more than half life points.
Yeah, but, definitely.
Yeah, and so stay away from that whenever he teleports into the center.
And you can see it coming when the shadow appears on the bridge. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, if you don't have the best reaction time or your connection's kind of flaky, as soon as you see that shadow, hit the search key.
Or as soon as you see the chat box, because the chat box will show up from Nomad. So whenever chat boxes from Nomad move onto the screen during the fight, move. That's usually a good idea. His other mechanic, Nomad's other mechanic, is... Feel my wrath or something like that.
Wrath or rage, and, not sure which, but...
Yeah, and he tosses his spear at you, and you basically just have to go around and try and hide behind, like, an outcropping, a wall of some sort.
Or a corner, or basically any obstacle you can find.
Yeah.
If you're using a defender or a shield, the resonance ability will protect you as well.
Mm-hmm.
So you have that going for you. If you took part in November's combat month...
Yes.
And I say that with a big grin.
Or if you have one of the old like bronze iron, one of the ancient defenders. Do those get the shield abilities too?
All defenders do, but if you were using anything other than melee, you would suffer a combat penalty for that.
Yeah, that's true.
So you got to keep that in mind when you're doing this.
Very good point.
Nomad has 100,000 life points.
In each phase, yes.
In each phase. And I don't know about you, but I just soul-splitted while I was doing this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep, same. Soul-splitting.
And I mean, I kept using ice, didn't need ice, probably could have switched to blood and regenerated more HP. I also had the vampirism aura going, so that helped as well. But aside from that, fighting Nomad was pretty simple here. The only other thing I'd like to add in is that I think it's on phase 3... He creates a copy of himself at 50,000 life points. So you basically have to kill 150,000 life points worth of Nomad.
Mm.
So.
Yeah. But, and one other combat mechanic, Gielinor will raise his hand and summon bombs onto your spot. So if you see him raise his hand, try and move away from that spot. So. But basically, you just go through, and other than that, nothing really changes. Throughout those four phases.
Yeah. You and I learned something, though, last night. If you gave Nomad a chunk of the stone or let him touch the stone in Dishonor Among Thieves, his rage attack is that same one life point attack that the previous Nomad had.
All but one, which, and if it's not, I think it's 7,200 or 7,500.
7,500, yeah.
So,
Duke, did you give him a chunk of the stone in Dishonor Among Thieves?
I did.
And ooh. Did you manage through this, or?
Yeah, I mean, just one other thing to deal with, but I mean, again, like, not knowing what these consequences would be later for letting him do it, I thought it was like, oh, this won't be a big deal, and then, well, maybe a little bit. I don't regret it, though. No regrets.
That's going to be a funny one when Earth does this quest.
Did he let him?
I don't know. I don't remember.
I want to say that he did, if I remember. I don't know. Maybe he didn't, but knowing Earth, I think he's apathetic enough to not care if he grabbed a piece. I don't know.
He'll manage. Okay, let's talk about the NPC combat, because this was annoying to a degree. Yeah. Ichthyrin, Death, Xenia, and that's it, right?
Yes, that is it.
So the first one being Xenia. This is perhaps the most straightforward one, because Xenia has basic combat abilities, and you basically just need to clear out the surrounding ring of ascension creatures. And, I mean, this one was easy, so I don't think we need to comment about Xenia's
NPC.
It's
just a matter of spam. Spamming your abilities.
Yeah, and maintaining life points. And if you die during, while controlling one of the NPCs, it is a safe death. And they do respawn with the same life points that they had initially. So that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Next one, of course, is Death. And, well, Death's... were you the one that was saying you had a bit of a problem getting its soul to come out?
Not me.
Oh, okay. Well, basically what happens with Death is you need to go to the north, south, east, and west portion of the square and then summon the soul, step a few squares back, walk back under the soul, use the scythe to scrape a soul out, then capture the soul. That's the mechanic for Death. And once again, this is something in this quest that is not intuitive.
So,
no. I mean, it's simple, but there's no manual to it. How long did it take you guys to figure that out?
A few minutes.
Yeah, maybe a minute.
Okay. All right. Then Ichthyrin. I think this one was probably the most annoying one.
Yes.
Because it has you running around in a square, and you are trying to capture souls by firing off an ability. And, I mean, yeah, you can do that, but when you do that, there's this giant beam that is following you, coming from Gielinor, that if it hits you, it will one-hit KO you. So basically, you need to keep ahead of it while trying to prevent it from gathering souls. You want to try and gather more souls than Gielinor, because if you do that, its final attack won't be as strong. Now, this is all fine and dandy, but when you couple in lag to your server, whatever kind of ping you have, and the tick rate of the game, it just doesn't feel as though this is a fair mechanic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, agreed.
Because
I mean, yeah, like lag, and I mean, definitely on like mini quests before this, like this one, it probably pays to go in your graphics settings and probably go on like a different setting just so you can have consistent graphics coming through, because if you don't, it's just going to be all that more difficult for no reason, really.
Okay, so you had some frame rate problems then?
Well, not like frame rate, but I mean, like, I used to play the game on higher graphics, and sometimes you get a little bit of lag just because of that. So, at least when it comes to quests, like, just reducing your graphics a little bit helps.
Okay. Just, I didn't have any frame rate issues, but it was just a an issue of keeping the client fast enough to make things happen. So, but anyways, after you suck up all the souls and get that down to zero, there will be a big beam that gets fired from Gielinor, and you need to activate the shield in order to dodge this attack. And you have to do this entire process twice. I had some trouble timing the shield. How about you guys?
Yep.
Yeah, it takes a little getting used to.
Yeah,
it's not timed well. If it shows the shield up, it doesn't necessarily mean you're protected.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a few seconds.
Yeah, and I think the easiest way to go about this is that once your souls are gathered, just activate that shield right away.
Yeah.
So,
And then quickly go around again because
yeah,
if you're
because
not quick, the beam will get you.
Yeah. So, and I mean, this is really my only nitpick about this quest is being, you know, the only problem with it. So, yep. I mean, that is in general a pretty good thing. So, mm-hmm. All right. And then after this, you finish fighting Nomad and you best him. And then you have choices to be made. So, after Great. You finish fighting Nomad, do you let him live or do you have him killed?
Death.
It's really a tough choice. I mean, I feel
Was
like
it,
kill's
though?
The obvious because, I mean, he's not a nice guy. But at the same time, like, and I've done this in other quests too, like, I've not necessarily killed people right off the bat just because I'm kind of a softy when it comes to deciding if people should live or die or not. But also, like, once you get to the end of the quest, just kind of, like, understanding, you know, that things will probably be different from what you necessarily pick. So, I mean, does it really matter which choice you make, per se?
Okay.
I mean, I don't know. I chose to kill him.
Yeah, I killed him as well. Colton?
Yeah, we all killed him.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that's a smart choice to do because he was supposed to be dead after the last quest, and when you kill someone, you expect them to stay dead. So...
Well, that, and you remember in the previous quest before, there was Dishonor Among Thieves, you basically take him out of Death's office when he's, like, trying to reap his soul. So you kind of owed him for that.
And I mean, I guess that's where the point comes in as to whether or not you choose to do that. But, I mean, we need to also remember that this whole thing was, of course, put on by Sliske. Sliske orchestrated this entire thing with Nomad. And he, of course, makes an appearance at the end of the quest.
And we'll probably see Nomad again as a white anyhow.
Yeah, yeah.
So you know what Sliske likes to do with dead bodies.
And I mean, that doesn't really mean that there's not much to make in decision-making here, because if Jagex needs Nomad, they'll find a way to make his white have the power that he needs to have in order to have the impact for the final quest in the series. So It's not a real decision that is going to have that much of a major role, unlike the next decision here that might have a major role, and that is who gets to kill the god called Gielinor. So who did you guys have kill Gielinor?
Death.
Okay.
I picked Death.
Interesting. Yes. I picked...
I like Death. I picked
Ichthorand for that. So why'd you guys choose Death?
I feel like it's his rightful place. He is the Reaper. It's his job, you know? And we owed it to, I don't know. I just felt it was fitting. I mean, Ichthorn's job is to ferry souls to the afterlife, and Death's job is to reap souls and to sort of, not really pass judgment, but, and he's also a guardian of Guthix. And being that sort of sense of balance and outside of godhood, things like that, I think it was good for him from the World Guardian's perspective to gain some power.
All right. I can see it that way. I just went for Ichthorin because he's in general the character I prefer, and I knew that there's going to be some movement on the scoreboard after this. So I figured, oh, this is probably going to be something to do with moving on the Sliske scoreboard. So I thought, okay, I'd much rather see Ichthorin move up rather than Death. So,
really?
Yeah.
So that's how I made my decision. And, you know, unlike other decisions, it's not... It was a quick decision, so I didn't really think about this one as much as I thought about the other decisions in this quest.
Mm-hmm.
What about at the end of the quest, letting Zanuck live or not?
Of course I let her live.
Yeah, same.
I mean, if you let her live in the other quests, like, how could you not let her live in this one? I mean, you just kind of have to go with what you've done before.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, it's not as though it's coming back to life for 100%. She only gets a few more years. So there is that caveat, but we'll talk more about her outlook after we wrap everything up. So scoreboard changes as a result of this. The World Guardian, you appear on the scoreboard with a win plus one for, I assume, defeating Nomad, I guess, or...
Maybe. Being able to finish the quest.
Or defeating Gielinor. Well, I mean,
we get a point for defeating Nomad, and Nomad was so powerful that it warranted a point, according to Suske.
All right. And, of course, Ichthyrin or Death also gets a kill on this scoreboard for killing Gielinor based on the player's decision. So there's some interesting discrepancies right there. And, of course, Suske manages a way to find himself to add a win.
Good for Sliske.
Yeah,
I think this scoreboard's a little rigged.
And it really is. It really is. Yeah. He gets a point for orchestrating this whole thing and, well, at the end of the day, pulling off a great quest. That's probably the way he sees it.
Yeah.
Now, this is something we came to in terms of a revelation last night about this quest. And that is that with Ichthyrin and Death each having the ability to get a kill plus one, and the fact that, you know, some players could have him be higher or lower on the scoreboard, depending, that leads me to believe that Ichthyrin and Death will not play a major role in the final Sliske's endgame.
Yeah,
maybe.
I don't think that it's kind of back to that illusion of choice.
Yep.
Type thing rather than the actual impactful choices. I think it was just sort of look, the character did things. I don't think it'll come to actual fruition and do too much. It might have, like, in the end, someone does, I don't know, maybe they could win, and then the stone just gets in different hands by some other means, but I seriously doubt it.
All right. I honestly think that it's ultimately going to be the World Guardian that ends up maintaining the stone now that we have a presence on this scoreboard.
So yeah. I think we're going to kill gods?
Well, I wouldn't say kill gods, but we'll definitely... you know, be able to use the stone, become more powerful, and maybe enact some form of Guthix's edicts once again and get rid of the gods. Because, I mean, would it be within our realm as World Guardian to do something like that?
Yeah.
Potentially.
I think
it depends on, because, you know, like, think about Guthix. Like, he had a whole lot of power in order to put the edicts in place, like, you know, being a tier 2 god, I think it was.
Yep.
You know, basically on the same level as Zaros and Saren, and basically, and like, kind of over the course of the quest, you kind of come to understand that these, like, gods you thought were really strong, like Saradomin and Zamorak and Armadil and whatnot, like, are really not the top dogs. They're kind of like in the middle of the mix. And so, I mean, I don't know where that exactly puts the player, but I feel like we don't necessarily have that capacity to just do it ourselves, but we can, like, influence things to go a certain direction.
Yeah, I think we're tier 7 right now, right?
We're on a completely different plane. We're not even able to be considered on the tiers of godhood, because we are the opposite of a god. We're sort of the anti-god.
All right.
In terms of the actual raw power that the World Guardian possesses to kill a god, I don't think we can unless we use an Elder artifact. We have the measure in our banks, but that's... So we need to have possession of, like, Staff of Armadil, the Horn, I don't know, other things.
And I mean, that would create a whole other issue as well if we kill a god and using an elder artifact there. So, I don't know. It's definitely going to be interesting to see where this goes with World Guardian having a role to play in the end game here. So, Moving past that, was Nomad's idea of a god based on Gielinor something that would have had merit? I mean, granted that we would have, we wouldn't have wanted Nomad to have a controlling stake in this god, but we were able to defeat Nomad. Could we have potentially wrestled control of Gielinor away from Nomad if he didn't die, or both of them didn't die?
Well, I think on the first part, just like the idea of having a god, like what's the purpose? Like, I don't know if that gets entirely fleshed out, just kind of like, okay, so you create it and then you control it, but are you going to kill other gods? Are you going to actually protect Gielinor? Are you going to like subjugate all of Gielinor under your control?
Yeah, that really wasn't made clear in this quest, was it?
Yeah, but knowing Nomad's psyche is probably not going to be good. And then like on the second part, like we, you know, would we have been able to wrestle away control? I mean, it's a good what if, but I don't know if we would have had the ability to do that.
All right. Colton, any thoughts on that?
In terms of the actual concept, I think a man-made god is always a flawed concept. It just seems like he was setting himself up for failure. I don't think it was a good idea from the first place. With regards to actually being able to take control, I don't think so. Gielinor, from what we saw, seemed almost feral, like wild, and it would have taken some serious power to be able to control, especially if we'd kill. I wonder what would have happened had we killed Nomad before. Yeah, because we killed Gielinor right before we killed Nomad. So had we killed Nomad, would it have severed some link? Would he would have gone on a rampage? We'll never know. But yeah, I don't think that we would have been able to.
Yeah, that would definitely be an interesting question. What would have happened if Gielinor, or rather Nomad, was killed before Gielinor? So
yeah,
very interesting question. Just a couple more things before we wrap this up here. Was the combat okay, or should it have been harder?
I didn't have any problems with it. It seemed a little easy for a Nomad quest, but not something ridiculously easy that I think a good amount of people died during the quest. Not nearly as many as who would have died during the initial release of Nomad's Requiem, but I don't think that combat was really the focus of this quest, even though they hyped it up quite a bit.
Who was saying it was going to be as hard as the first wave of Araxor? Was that a community thing, or did the JMod actually say that?
It was a JMod statement. I can't remember if that was during a live stream or if it was on a news post, but it was a JMod statement. That it would be 300% enraged Araxor, which is the hardest version of Araxor. For those who don't know Araxor speak, that's after you've done Araxor several times throughout the day, and it's the hardest mode you can do it on. So, yeah.
I think that was probably just trying to scare everyone.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was definitely hyperbolic.
Yeah, but... and I mean, when you're designing a boss for a quest, that has to be different than when you're designing for...
Oh yeah,
the PVM community, because it's whole different audience who's going to be fighting this. You're going to be having people who do not do combat outside of quests, and people do not have tier 90 gear. So the quest does need to be doable with Barrow's gear. And I think you could make an argument that you could pull this off with Barrow's gear if you really tried hard.
Yeah. Oh yeah, especially because it'll save your progress between waves.
Yeah, and you can bank, right? So
yeah. And the biggest spikes of damage are usually flat damage. It's normally not like just the actual regular DPS that Nomad does. It's more his special attacks. Like if you keep getting hit by those by his spear attacks, yeah, it's gonna hurt you. If you keep getting hit by Gielinor's hand, you're gonna need to eat. But if you can avoid those things, you don't really need much tanking gear. It's more DPS.
Exactly. All right, so after this quest, if you let Zanuck live, she becomes the guardian of Soul Wars. And if you do not, well, she returns to the afterlife being dead, and Zimmerfizz's ashes become the guardian of Soul Wars.
Did either of you choose that option?
No, because remember, I let her live at the end.
Okay, yeah. Darn it. Had I known. No.
Had a little pile of ashes, eh?
Yeah, it would have been humorous.
Indeed.
But would anyone really notice? Like, does anyone still play Soul Wars?
No.
No.
Yeah. It's just one of those things that, like, even if you make the choice, you're not going to, like, notice it ever.
That's true. Good point.
Indeed. All right. Well, I think that's about right for this quest. So unless there's anything else that needs to be discussed, we'll just move on to the rewards.
Nope.
All right. So one quest point and 50,000 XP and construction, mining, woodcutting, and a combat skill of your choice. You also get invention blueprints for the soul in the box and the urn enhancer. Soul in the box enhances pickpocketing. Meanwhile, urn enhancer gives you an extra 25% XP when you teleport an urn away. So dwarf trader thieving just got a whole lot more powerful here. I haven't got a chance to test it out, but I'm assuming that this will stack with things like the Traherne exoskeleton, crystal mask spell, and whatnot. So it's going to be very interesting to see what thieving looks like after this update.
Yeah, I'd like to hear what the rates would be at maximum.
Yeah, I'll have to look into that. Urn enhancer, do you guys use urns?
Yeah, whenever I do those sorts of skills.
Okay. I don't, because they take up an extra inventory space, and I don't know. I just was not a fan of the urn update when it first came out. So
they boost XP, man. They're awesome.
Yeah, and I use urns occasionally, usually just for fishing, but that's about it.
Alrighty. Well, there's Nomad's Elegy in a nutshell in just over an hour, so hopefully that didn't put anyone to sleep. And, I mean, if it did, well, then you should reconsider your RuneScape priorities in terms of questing.
Yeah. But
anyways, let's move on to some quick tweaks and fixes this week. Not too many as the previous week, but first up, Nomad's model and animations have been updated in the Nomad's Requiem and the Dominion Tower to be, of course, the modern animations that we saw at Nomad's Elegy, so that is good. Drop table for Chaos Giants has been greatly improved, bringing it more in line with their requirements, including a very rare Dragon Pickaxe drop.
Ooh.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's not just the Chaos Dwarfs that you can fight for the chance of a Dragon Pick, but they say very rare, so I'd still put my money on the Chaos Dwarfs instead.
Yeah.
And then some here for Colton, or previously for Colton. Loot Beam has been changed from 50,000 to 50,001 value coins for the following items. Most of them are journals, including Calabath Journal, Phalanx Experiment Log, Sackerth Journal, and Strythus Journal. The Forsay's Journal Pages, Miner's Journals Numbers 1 to 5, and the Diary of Jebediah Omnis, also the Agthonatos, Kagi's Journal and Kagi's Journal Pages, Ancient Pages, Scabarite Notes, History of the Order and Order Journal Pages, Ancient Elven Wedding Ring, Clarence's Body Parts, and the 4K's Journal Pages. Oh, that one was in there twice. Sorry about that.
I could swear that the Ancient Elven Wedding Ring didn't even have a beam for it beforehand, not even at the 50,000 level.
Yeah, I think I remember Tannis talking about that, so.
Yeah, I got it and was like, oh, there was just no fanfare. I'd been hunting it for hours and hours and then no beam, but, I mean, at least I saw it, so.
Yeah, and I mean, these are all Master Quest Cape requirements, I think, mm-hmm. So it's good, yes, that they are adding a beam to them, because you do not want to be missing out on these, because some of them are pretty rare, I think, right?
Yes, quite.
So.
Especially that stupid wedding ring.
Are you happy you went for it?
Oh, yeah. I'm so glad I have it.
Okay.
I'm just afraid that they're going to add more. They'll do it eventually. They'll add more requirements eventually. I just don't want it to happen. I just want to keep it. I love it.
Yeah. All right. Well, this past week, a week ago, the RuneScape 15th anniversary documentary premiered in London. And as a result of that, Jagex has unveiled the winner of their 15th anniversary movie competition poster. And that winner was, I believe I'm saying this right, Bitcoinich. And you can see the photo of his poster in the notes or on the RuneScape webpage for the Nomad's Elegy quest. I think that looks pretty good. Looks like we got a King Black Dragon in the background. The Adventurer, obviously.
Sort of Edix, kind of looks like. I can't tell, though.
Kind of looks like it.
Oh, maybe. Maybe, yeah.
Kind of modeled after that.
That's a good observation there.
It's a nice simplistic image. The other ones are very, and I like all the runner-ups, but this one's, I mean, it's just sharp contrast with grays and whites and blacks, and it's just a nice outline and silhouettes of things. I think it's very artistically.
Yeah, and seen. I mean, good work on the typography as well, so I'm happy with this.
Yeah, it looks nice.
Yep,
definitely.
Alrighty, folks. Also, this week we do have a polling update for the new RuneLabs area that will be a part of the Eastern Lands. Currently, in first place, we have the Slayer / Combat area with about 17.7k votes, followed by the Skilling Boss at 17.1k votes, and then the First Contact quest is in third with 12.6k, and then rounding out the other choices, Hunter area with 7.6k votes and PvP area with around 4,000 votes.
Vote Skilling Boss, please.
Yeah, and I mean, the question is, and I discovered this earlier in the year with the survey that I did out in the RS community, and the vast majority of players make their money by way of Slayer or Combat. And of course, remember the second and third almost tied choices are PVM and Skilling. So obviously everyone just loves Slayer, and it appears as though this has permeated its way into this month's RuneLabs poll, in so much so that the Slayer combat area is winning.
Much to my chagrin.
Yeah, and I mean, it speaks to a one-dimensional nature of the way that the players consider RuneScape, in terms of being, you know, the Slayer combat game like that. I would very much like to see this turned on its head sometime this year, giving people reasons to do other things rather than Slayer. We get that Slayer is great and everything, but as a whole, I think players need to broaden their horizons just a bit, and that's something we hope to achieve this year, if you remember what I said on my opening monologue of 2016 RSBANDB update. So...
yep.
I voted for the Skilling Boss as well. I also did give a vote to the First Contact quest, just because it's a quest, and, I mean, quests are always good, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
But, I mean, at this point, there's about 4 days left, so I don't think we'll be seeing the First Contact quest win. So the effort has to be around moving the Skilling Boss into first place and maybe pulling votes away from the Slayer / Combat area. And, you know, this, in a nutshell, speaks to the whole thing about RuneLabs and player suggestions in general. It's that you don't get any originality, I feel. Like, if there is originality, it doesn't appear, whether it be, you know, a new Hunter area, the Skilling Boss, or the First Contact quest that made it into the poll, or even my idea that I supported last week of Eastern Lands farming. So,
yeah,
it's just hard getting people to think outside of their natural wheelhouse, which I think is unfortunate, because all these ideas, except for maybe the ports adventurer, sound kind of interesting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And we discussed this sort of thing last night on RS Weekly. It's like, and it's sort of the whole, you don't want, people don't know what they want, you know? You need to tell them what they want. And show them what they want.
So
yeah.
I mean, if you are listening to this on the weekend, please do vote for the skilling boss and get your friends to vote as well.
I think a lot more people are going to vote this weekend because it's just going to grab people who are on only play on weekends. Kind of going to what you're saying. Like, I kind of wish the polls were sometimes a little more informative rather than like binding for what would actually be put in the game. Like, rather than saying, oh, well, this one only won by 100 votes, but that's the one we're going to go with. Like, why can't, you know, either include two or, like, have a runoff, essentially. And that's kind of another problem with this poll is it's like you can choose as many of these as you want. And I feel like people are saying, oh, well, yeah, of course I want Slayer and a Skilling Boss, like, both of them. It's like, well, can't we just, like, pick one or the other? I feel like that would kind of change people's minds, too.
I don't think you can do a runoff voting system because, I mean, oddly, we discussed that on RS Weekly as well. I don't know if you're like, looking at a screen, Duke, or if you're browsing the RuneScape subreddit, but that was suggested there.
No, I wasn't looking there. But it's kind of crossed my mind. Like, you know, when you have two that are so close like that, I feel like you'd get support, you know, that people could, if they didn't initially vote for those, that you should kind of have an option to include those people.
I think that if we'd done a ranking system, like you just slide each option to where you feel like first, second, third, fourth, fifth options, I think that would have been really simple and would have been a better way to go about these sorts of polls.
Yeah, because the checkboxes are blind as it is.
Yes, I agree.
And I mean, there's argument to say that you don't necessarily even need to use the in-game polling system for this. Just go based on, you know, what we see as the top 5 or 10 items on RuneLabs and then turn it over to JAX internally, because I would much rather have them making these decisions, because when was the last time we had an update centered around Slayer? We had an entire month in November.
And right now, Invention is sort of an extension of Slayer.
Yay! Well, maybe until next week. We'll have to wait and see on that.
Yeah, hopefully.
But,
cross fingers.
Yeah. So, you weren't on the show back then, but do you remember in November how each week one of these new Slayer bosses would come out and the general sentiment was that, oh, it's too hard. There's a problem with X mechanic. There's a problem with something about this boss, and we don't like it. I think the first one was that the loot wasn't as good for the Wyverns, and then for the Ripper Demons, the problem was that you couldn't get away from the attack if there was lag, which is understandable. I don't think the Camels had any problems, did they?
Except for the fact that they wouldn't drop the lore journals off task.
Yeah, and the Mammoths, well, I think they were just too big of a task to fight for some people. So,
yeah.
People wanted high level Slayer and they got upset when they couldn't just AFK these creatures. So, if you ask
for some of it was rightly placed because the drops were bad, but we've already dug into that rabbit hole before. I won't take that back. Regardless.
So. I don't know, and I mean, we don't know what the Slayer in combat area would look like, because, you know, the player can suggest something, but JX doesn't necessarily have to go exactly with what the player suggests on that. So there is that caveat that even though the player suggested something, that might not be what the final product ends up looking like.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. Vote for the Slayer update. I mean, No. I did not mean to say that at all.
Freudian slips, Shane.
Yeah, I got to be careful with those.
Slayer.
Vote for the skilling boss and tell your friends about it. And let's see if we can get this to move at all by Monday, I believe, is when it ends. Or Tuesday, depending on the time.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So next up, the Mimic has arrived. Treasure Hunter bossing experience. The first boss to be gated behind a bit of a Treasure Hunter content. So basically what happens is each day you get 5 chances to loot the Mimic. The Mimic is available via a portal in Borthorp, very close to the Lodestone. You can fight the Mimic as many times as you want, but you can only loot it up to 5 times a day. you can get extra loot tokens on Treasure Hunter, or, and I say this with a big underscore and bold type font, you can buy the tokens on the Grand Exchange. So you are not outright required to spend money if you want to keep looting this on Treasure Hunter, because the Mimic has the ability to drop a rare cosmetic tradable tongue cape. So, I mean, I think that the Mimic is an interesting idea from a mechanics point of view to get people maybe get people's feet wet in terms of bossing if they might not be familiar with boss practice mode. But with that being said, it's a very unpolished update. At least that's what I found. I don't know if you tried it, Duke, but Colton?
Yeah, we tried it, and it feels awkward. It just feels like they glued mechanics onto this model, and it just doesn't feel quite right. I have more problems with it just from the fact that I feel like this is really getting close to a line that I don't think Jagex should cross, gating too much in-game content behind a paywall. But I just have an idea that I think they really could have done this a lot better. I just want to get your guys' opinion on it. So you know how Araxor, the more you fight it, basically it gets harder each time you fight it?
Yes.
So instead of making it a hard ceiling on Mimic, to where basically you cannot fight it after the fifth time and get rewards, I think if they would have made it so that it increases in difficulty exponentially up to the fifth time, basically where it becomes the elite version, and that's the only version you can fight for the rest of the day until it resets. But you're still able to, if you can manage to kill it at that difficulty, you can still loot the monster itself. If they'd done that instead of setting the hard cap and making, instead of selling tickets to kill the monster on Treasure Hunter, they would have sold tickets to basically the Araxite pheromone, to where it can reset its enraged counter, if you will, and to make it easier if you buy the Treasure Hunter keys and are able to spin the wheel, as it were. I just feel like that would have been a better mechanic, and I think people, it would have been a little bit easier to swallow in terms of it wouldn't seem quite as paywalled if you're willing to put in a lot of time to learn the mechanics. I don't know. Maybe that's just me.
That's a very good idea. I like that idea a lot. I think that pretty much would remove a good number of the concerns about this. And, I mean, the fact that you only use up a token when you loot it, I think that also helps as well. And you can buy them on the exchange. That helps tremendously because they just only started doing that recently. So taking it one step further to what you suggested would also be great. So I think that's a great idea. Some of the Mimic's drop table items include new mini protein packs, each containing 10 protein items, rare item tokens, Scrimshaws of Aggression, Sacrifice, Corruption are back, as well as combat training dummies, springs, and feathers. I fought the medium version and I got a grand total of 5,000 GP.
Just one time, you mean?
Yeah, just one time.
Well, again, kind of like you're saying, it's, you know, back to the player poll where people are like focused on combat and kind of like things like this reward people who combat's their specialty. It's like, yeah, I'm going to fight the elite one because no one else can do it. And, you know.
Whoop-de-doo, right? So.
Yeah.
And I mean, when you think about it, what you're getting the chance to get is very expensive, because the default price for the tongue cape is 250 mil on the Grand Exchange, so of course that is obviously going to be going for higher than that as it is right now,
at least. And, the first few,
I mean, I don't know who would want something like this, but
it's ugly.
Exactly. Though that's what we said about the fish mask, and the fish mask kind of took off.
No, it didn't.
Well, initially, but then it went down.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
I think
yeah,
it's down to 1 or 2 mil now. But
exactly. So,
compared to something like Crown of Seasons, which is like something
exactly
a lot
nice.
Of people would want.
Yeah.
And I mean, the tongue cape started off at 250, whereas I don't know what the fish mask started at, but I mean, there's a big difference right there. So,
yeah.
Anyways, I mean, Mimic, I think it's justifiable as it is right now. I think you guys do have a point with it, you know, wanting to be worried about this, but it's not nearly as bad as it could be. And I think Colton, if they adopted something like you said, would go a great way to allaying any fears that might exist about this. So,
especially if they want to do it in the future again. I mean, I think that would be a much better way to go about it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, alrighty. Anything else on the Mimic?
Nope.
Not really. The only thing I'd say is, like, with these weekend event specials they do, I don't know. It's kind of annoying for me anyway, because I just feel like I can't keep up with all the different events they do
right.
every weekend.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of like something that they do to attract people over the weekend, which is like fine. Like, I don't really necessarily have a problem with that, but it's hard for me to keep up and kind of take advantage of like the whole event. And it only lasts like, you know, 3 or 4 days. So,
yeah, that's very true. Very true.
Yeah.
But other than that, it's nice that they put out this kind of content and give something for weekend players to look forward to.
Okie dokie then. Some other news here. RuneScape Chronicle is going to be having its open beta on March 23rd. And as a result, everyone from the closed beta has had their stats reset. So, I mean, we didn't play it that much during the closed beta, but stats will be reset. And if you did have access to the closed beta, you get access on March 16th, as well as you'll be rewarded with a title, card back, emblem, and a cache of copper coins for your help so far. They're also going to be bringing out new features, including some new legends, including Vanescula and Morvrin after launch. Also, Dungeoneering, a new mode featuring draft decks, PvP challenges, and rich rewards. What do you guys think about Dungeoneering making its way into this game?
I mean, it's kind of interesting because basically they're making it so that you have to sort of build your own deck from scratch, kind of like in Dungeoneering. You don't have your normal weapons and your normal armor to go face your foes, so you sort of have to make your way with what you're given, kind of thing. I think it's interesting and kind of a cool twist on something that's already present in the lore of the game.
Having played like Hearthstone already, this is like exactly what Arena is. And so, I mean, it's just kind of like, you know, when you have a game out there that kind of does the same thing.
Careful there. Have you played Chronicle?
No.
Yeah.
Not yet.
You have no right to compare it to Hearthstone. Thank you very much.
Not yet.
No, it's nothing like Hearthstone.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. So, You also have customization options showing off your style with legend skins and skilling themed titles. I wonder if there'll be something farming related for me.
Who knows?
One can hope.
New locations, including the Wilderness Crater and Barrows, will be featured, as well as better game performance.
Interesting.
Yeah, so that'll be good to look at. And one of the reasons I didn't invest too much time in the Chronicle closed beta after initially giving it a fair shake was that I knew the stats were going to be reset and I didn't want to put too much time into it because of that. So
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, it was fun, but I don't know. I'm not a traditional card player type person. I had a lot of fun. I just got really frustrated because I feel like there are a lot of people out there who know those sorts of strategy games more so than I do. And it would have been a steep learning curve for me. And I feel like a lot of people who were in the open beta were people who knew a lot about those kinds of games. And so I was kind of behind the eight ball, as it were.
Yeah,
so,
well, I mean, we had some great fun in our battles, didn't we?
Yeah.
Remember you killed yourself?
I did. I very well did. Gloriously. Yeah.
Anyways,
I'm not good at card games.
Let's move on to our next game featuring the RuneScape name, and that is RuneScape Idle Adventures coming in spring 2016. So RuneScape Idle Adventures is a new game being made in collaboration with our good friends over at Hyper Hippo, the mad geniuses responsible for the wildly popular Adventure Capitalist. And they're massive fans of RuneScape and have been working closely with us on a fresh, successful take of the emerging idle game genre. It's an addictive, quick-to-play RPG boiled down to the basics of leveling and looting. In a typical session, you'll spend a few minutes making choices for your customizable hero, then leaving him or her to train, fight, and quest in real time. So.
Interesting.
Yeah. The first thing I heard about this, hearing RuneScape Idle Adventures upon logging into RS, is that, oh, Jagex wants us to idle more.
That's what I heard, too.
Yeah. And, I mean, that's not exactly a fair statement to make, because this is not RuneScape at all. This is an entirely different game in itself.
Another source of revenue, really.
Yeah, it is. And, I mean, I think we've proven this over time, is that RuneScape is the success story of Jagex. So if they can expand out into things like Chronicle and now this and who knows what else in the future, as long as it brings back money to Jagex that fosters development within RuneScape itself, that is of course a great thing to be happening for our game that we all play. I've never played Adventure Capitalist, but this will be available on the PC, iOS, and Android. So, or iOS and Android later in the year, rather. And, you know, the one thing I think that they need, if they're going to be making all of these games tie back into RuneScape, is some general way to connect them. Now, I'm not saying you need to have shared stats or anything, you know, grand like that, but just as long as there's some way to, I mean, maybe a cosmetic in RuneScape showing you've garnered a certain achievement in Chronicle or Idle Adventures. Something
yeah,
like that.
Some kind of overlap, yeah.
It would be kind of nice.
I mean, what they could have done is they could have made Ports its own game and then tied that into RuneScape with the armor rewards and whatnot. I still think that would have been a great thing to do. Hmm. But it never happened that way.
No.
But Ports as it is pretty great, I think, if you don't do player-owned ports and you have a level 90 stat, definitely go on, check it out at Port Sarum. And,
yeah.
I mean, the only reason I think you wouldn't know about this is if you started playing or were taking a break after it launched in, what was that?
2012. Late 2012,
okay.
Yeah.
Because, of course, the very famous player-owned ports Ahoy song.
Heck. Yep.
So, I think ultimately this is a great step forward. You guys have anything else on Idle Adventures before we move on?
I mean, I just think that as long as it's a good name to put the RuneScape name on, then I'm totally fine with it, even if I don't really care about the game.
Yeah, I agree. And I mean, you can have a similar kind of thing for Betrayal at Falador 2, the book. That had the RuneScape name on it, but a very good chunk of the player base has never read it or really knew what went on in that novel. So they have had forays into other areas.
Your thoughts, Duke?
I mean, I think it's definitely like an eye-catching title for a game. People are kind of like, well, what's this about? But I'm going to hold judgment before, you know, assuming it's going to be this lame, you know, play, but you're not really playing that much. I'd like to see more about it. I'm interested to see what
yeah.
it would be like.
Agreed.
Alrighty. And our final piece of RS news for this week is featuring the NXT client and the RuneScape platform statistics. So, as of today, 3% of RuneScape users still use Windows XP. 35% use Windows 7. 50% are on Windows 8 or 8.1. And 3% are on Windows 10. Meanwhile, 6% use a version of macOS, with 10.11 El Capitan having the largest market share, and 0.5% use Linux. And The rest are on older versions of Windows, end quote. So older versions of Windows being Millennium, 2000, 98, 95, I guess, but I don't know that Java still runs on 95 and 98, come to think of it.
Kudos to the holdouts.
Is it sad to you, Shane, that the same percentage of people are still using Windows XP that are also using Windows 10?
It is, really, because, I mean, Windows 8 came out at the tail end of July last year, and you have a year free to upgrade from 8 to 10. And the fact 50% are not moving to Windows 10 is definitely concerning to me. I mean, there's nothing wrong with Windows 10. When Windows 8 came out, we heard all the horror stories of how people hated the start menu and hated the, you know, the start screen, rather. But Windows 10 fixes all that. So if you like Windows 7, there's no reason not to get Windows 10. And I have this deep fear within me that the people who play RuneScape are such old holdouts, having 85% of them using Windows 7 or 8, that they're part of that Windows 10 conspiracy group who feels that Microsoft is spying on you with Windows 10, which, I mean, it's going to happen with any operating system. Any modern operating system connected to the internet is sending data to whether it be Apple or Microsoft, depending who you are. So it's happening on OS 10. It's also happening on Windows 7. You just don't know it. In fact, you probably installed an update that allowed Microsoft to gather statistics from your computer without you knowing it. So, I honestly just shook my head when I saw this. I wish that these two numbers were reversed for, Windows 8 and Windows 10. That would be great to see that. But I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, I admit I'm one of the people in the Windows 7 category. I haven't upgraded yet. And I'm definitely not, like, concerned with, like, the whole spying thing. I mean, exactly how you put it, Shane. Like, if they're going to do it, they're going to do it. So that's not, like, what's holding me back.
Yeah. And see, the thing is, you have until July 29th of this year to get a free copy of Windows 10 for the lifetime of your computer.
Right. Yeah. And so, I'm aware of that. So I'm definitely, like, thinking about it. And I probably won't wait until, like, the last minute if I do decide to upgrade, which I probably will. But I guess people don't really feel that rushed. But I don't know what the stats necessarily mean, per se. I don't know if it's, I don't think it's a conspiracy theory thing, but I think it's more of, you know, people are comfortable with what they know and use on a daily basis and trying to change operating system. You know, people just don't like to do it a lot. And I think that's kind of part of why you see these numbers like Windows 7, 35%, and Windows 8. So obviously a lot of people switched over from 7 to 8 or, you know, from Vista to 8. But there's still kind of that lag for Windows 10 to kind of be accepted by people.
Yeah, and I mean, in the first, I want to say, 2 weeks that Windows 10 came out, there were a couple issues with the automatic upgrading process, but that's all been ironed out by the time you guys are hearing this now, back in February. And I mean, 6 months ago, this came out and achieved mainstream status. So it's ready. Windows 10 is ready. And I mean, even if you're one of the types who prefers to do a fresh install every time you install Windows, you can even do that with Windows 10. You can get the installation media for it. And then basically what you do is you create your DVD, put it in, you can use your Windows 7 or Windows 8 key in order to install Windows 10 without much fuss. So if you haven't installed Windows 10 already, I'll put a link in the show notes to the coverage that we did of Windows 10 when it was first released, giving you 10 reasons to upgrade to Windows 10 and, I mean, various other stories about why you want to do this and why it is ultimately a good decision for you to make if you're on Windows 7 or Windows 8. And, I mean, I'm not saying everyone has that conspiracy theory. You're right, Duke. And it ultimately just comes down to inertia and the kind of people who play RuneScape. And in my household, I am in charge of running updates and whatnot. And if I do not run updates, they don't get updated. And that's for pure inertia of lacking the will to press a button that says install update. So
right.
That's probably what this is. A couple of other interesting little steps in here. They are building this for Ubuntu 14.04 Linux because they have development tools that can assist them while writing the new client. They have a very dedicated Linux community, that 0.5%, and there's lots of platforms in the future that they could support that are based on Linux. So by writing a Linux client, it definitely helps. Also, the HTML5 client is not out of the picture yet. It's not going to be available at launch, but they definitely do want to have a look at it so that RuneScape can still be played in a browser if that's how you want to play it eventually going forward. It's not ready yet. They're waiting for WebGL 2.0. So that's where the client is. And the NXT beta is happening this weekend. So, of course, we'll have coverage of that this weekend in probably the form of a micro update. And, of course, on next week's full RSBANB update as well.
Awesome.
Yeah, you guys looking forward to NXT?
Yep.
Yeah.
Colton?
I'm definitely ready for a new client.
Definitely, I am.
Yeah, and I mean, the 50 FPS limit of RS and draw distances, that's all going to be a thing of the past going forward. So let's hope that this client gets off to a good start. And those of you guys who are testing it, provide adequate bug reports if you encounter any bugs. Because remember, if you don't send in a bug, there's other people that have it, and you're just enhancing the beta process by sending bugs. So if you have access to the NXT beta when it arrives this weekend, please do submit bugs if you find any. Because if you don't, well, that's not helping anyone. It's not helping you, it's not helping me, and it's not helping the RuneScape community in general.
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty. Well, that's it for RS stuff this week. So I'd just like to remind everyone that if you want to send us questions for next week, you can do that. We don't have any questions this week because I was questing on Monday and I conveniently forgot to put up the questions topic, and we are recording this a day early on Thursday. So it didn't have the full amount of time to sit and draw attention that it normally does. So questions at rsbnb.com for questions, or update.rsbnb.com/ask if you want to post on our forums. And finally, if you want to leave us a voicemail, call 571-57-BNB, which translates to 571-572-2632.
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty, so onwards to tech news we go. Now, Apple has... Oh, thank you, Colton, for that update. Apparently the gap between 1 and 2 is now under 600 on the poll.
Mm-hmm.
Apple has released a letter to its customers stating their stance on encryption, because the government has asked Apple, namely the FBI, has asked Apple for help in decrypting one of the iPhones from the San Bernardino terrorist attack back in December. So basically, in this letter, Apple goes through the need for encryption and why Apple built all of the iPhones to have encryption that was unbreakable going forward from iOS 8 and I believe the iPhone 5S. And then they talk about the San Bernardino case and how they do not support terrorism, but the FBI has asked for help, and regardless of wanting to help and having no sympathy for terrorists, Apple is unable to do anything about this in order to help breaking the iPhone. And there's a very interesting or troubling reason for this. Troubling in the sense that if you do help to break the encryption of one iPhone, that can be used in the future to break encryption of other iPhones that might not be sanctioned by warrant or the appropriate authorities. So, basically how this works is that each time an iPhone is encrypted with a passcode from iOS 8 going forward, there is no way to break that encryption unless you specifically enter the correct passcode. And if you attempt to brute force the passcode by way of, you know, modifying the internal storage of the iPhone, you will wipe that iPhone and render it unusable after 10 failed attempts at bypassing the encryption. So this means even if you had a disk image of what that iPhone looked like, you could not brute force it because it would simply scramble the contents of that drive and you wouldn't be able to access it at all. So that is what this demand from the FBI states to get around, is saying that, okay, we don't want you to decrypt the data. We just want you to lower the guard that prevents an iPhone from being brute forced after 10 tries. And now, while you might say that, okay, Apple can do this, and then, you know, only use this technology in such a case where it's warranted by way of a legal warrant, there's a problem with this in that anyone in Apple who has access to this could leak this to a malicious third party, and then that third party could read any iPhone on the planet. Or worse, it could, you know, make its way onto the internet and be used maliciously. So if you open one iPhone, you essentially open all the iPhones. So it's a question of whether or not you want encryption on a device, because any kind of encryption that is degraded becomes useless. So it's either got to be strong encryption or no encryption at all. And that's the position that Apple is in as to whether or not they can allow this to happen or not. So thoughts, you guys?
Not for me.
Oh, okay. How about you?
Yeah, it's definitely a sticky issue. You know, it's kind of something that ever since, you know, 9/11 especially, they've been trying to work through issues of privacy and encryption and getting access to data. You know, like, it wasn't only, what, 2-3 years ago, there was the whole fuss over the NSA just doing all this bulk collection of data.
Yeah.
And, I mean, basically the government's like, well, we're kind of still doing that, but we also just want you to take off, like, the protections of getting to other people's data that we can't get to. It's like, well, we understand why you want to do it, but is it really necessary? You know, does the benefit of doing so outweigh the negative impact it could have in the future?
I don't know. It's hard for me because I always have felt that if it would be a significant, I don't know, because I straddle the line between wanting privacy and, honestly, although I like privacy, I think I'd prefer safety because,
yep.
And again, it comes back to the thing where it's like, I don't have anything to hide. Like, I don't know. And, personally, I don't mind.
And see, I would have no problem with Apple building a device that can disable this protection and allow something to be brute forced and handing it over to the FBI or whoever, right?
I think it should require considerable warrant.
Exactly. It would require that. But what if you get someone in the FBI or Apple who is dirty and takes this technology and gives it to a foreign power? Or, well, I mean, of course, have to go to a foreign power. But, or gives it to, you know, some hacker group, right? You yeah. open yourself up to breaking all the encryption if you do that. So you either do it or you don't.
I understand what you're saying, Colton. I think a lot of people, they don't really have much to hide, but it's just kind of the idea that, you know, if that was the case, like, do you necessarily leave your door open? Like, not even closed and unlocked, just open for, like, anyone to walk in? It's just kind of...
It's how much do you trust your government, really?
Yeah, I mean, that's what it boils down to.
Yeah.
So, and, I mean, even if Apple were to say we're disabling encryption on the devices, people would move to other platforms and other phones that do have the ability to run third-party encryption of the drive. So it's still going to happen. And in my view, like I said a couple weeks ago with the Twitter story, it's better to have the bad guys on a platform that is controlled by the good guys rather than having them use some open source decentralized platform that's controlled by no one. So, I mean, I think an interesting thing to look at in terms of Apple's cooperation would be what would happen if it wasn't an American institution that asked for this. What if it was China that asked for this, or India, or Saudi Arabia that asked for a technology like this to break an iPhone? Would Apple still put up as much of a fuss that they're putting up against the U.S. government?
Depends on how much money they're offered.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But
I mean, that's a cynical way of looking at it. But I mean, I still think that, you know, I think with how important the issue is, I think it's a matter of, you know, you do have to decide now, you know, is it going to be something that you're completely for or completely against? Because there really isn't much middle ground. And once you decide, you just go from there.
Yeah. And I mean, if I had to decide, I would have to say, I mean, we're living in times where all kinds of atrocities can happen. And if, you know, there was some kind of info on this phone that was foreshadowing a future attack that's potentially worse than what happened, if it means encryption needs to be broken, then that's something that needs to be done to protect people. So, like, you have to choose. You can't have a middle ground with encryption. You either have it or you don't.
Yeah.
So, it's also worth noting in closing on this story that both Microsoft and Google have put their support behind Apple on this front, as well as communications app WhatsApp has as well. So those are three other big players who are supporting Apple in this. All right. And unless there's anything else on that, I'm going to move on to our next tech news story.
Sounds good.
Yep.
Okay. Facebook will be putting ads in Messenger by the second quarter of 2016. So that is the messaging application that people use aside from Facebook to communicate with, well, I guess what would probably be the vast majority of their friends. So you're going to see ads in there. I would assume those ads are going to be tailored to what you have been talking about or what you have recently liked on the service. I don't think there's any reason people can complain about this, because that's something you offer when you go to Facebook. You offer all of the data about yourself, what you like and what you talk about. So you're kind of being sold here. But
it just seems like it would be a bit annoying.
Yeah, it would. And I mean, I don't know if people would abandon the platform for that, but
who knows? I don't know many people who use it religiously, but maybe that's just me.
I use it very sparingly. I usually use Skype or like iMessage more than I use Messenger. I mean, I remember when Messenger came out for Facebook, and I was kind of like, why are they separating these two out? I don't know if that's just
because they wanted to help kill texting.
I mean, I guess, but I mean, essentially, you have to have a Facebook account if you want to use it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, unfortunately, but
so it's kind of like you can't have one without the other. But I mean, I think it all depends on how they place the ads and what the ads are. I think it'll be kind of similar to what they do now, where ads will be based on kind of what your Facebook profile is, what you've said, what you've liked, that kind of stuff. I know some apps are better than others in terms of how they present ads, like how much space it takes up, if it takes up like the whole screen or it's just a little banner ad. I think, you know, the less intrusive, I think the better it is for users, but potentially not so much for ad revenue. So it's definitely a fine line they have to figure out.
Yeah. And the best way to do it would just be to have it look like a message itself. So, we'll have to monitor what happens on this front, but you guys have been notified that that's going to be coming to your messaging platform in a couple months' time.
Could be a good time to invest in Facebook.
I think that's always a good time based on what they started off at.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a new way of revenue for them, which, you know, it'll definitely increase their value. And so just a passing thought.
Yeah, it's probably their most popular app. But anyways, next piece of tech news, we'll just run through quickly. The U.S. Department of Defense commits to upgrade 4 million seats to Windows 10. So even less than a year after its release, Microsoft has made its way into the Department of Defense and upgrading 4 million of their computers to use Windows 10, which is really odd because normally enterprise computing, especially Department of Defense enterprise computing, runs behind by a couple years. So this is very interesting from a security point of view that the Department of Defense is willing to go with such a new platform. So that says something about Windows 10, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I think it definitely speaks to, you know, Windows is pushing really hard, or Microsoft's pushing really hard to make this kind of their last, you know, major software release. And then after that, it'll just be, you know, upgrades and updating and all that stuff. And I think this definitely speaks to that aspect and how the, you know, Department of Defense wants to buy it now and be like, yeah, let's just upgrade all at the same time and won't have to, you know, deal with upgrading in the future.
Yeah,
I mean, heck, if you're a Windows user who hasn't upgraded yet, and now bureaucracy is moving faster than you, I think that's saying something.
Yeah, and I mean, that is, I think, the number one reason at this point to move to Windows 10 is that, you know, they said it was going to be the last version of Windows, and I think lots of people didn't believe that when it was initially said. But they say last version, that really does mean last version that you're going to have to go through a convoluted install process to do. And when I say convoluted, I just mean it's more involved than your standard run-of-the-mill update, when in reality, the Windows 10 installation process is a lot simpler than Windows 7 or 8 ever was. So there's no reason not to upgrade out of fear of it taking too long or it being too hard to upgrade, especially if the Department of Defense is doing it. But there's also Windows 10 security features that the Department of Defense is looking at that it, quote, may incorporate, including Windows Hello, which is Microsoft's authentication platform that basically reduces the risk of passwords being hacked or compromised. Basically, using Windows 10 Hello, agencies can identify individuals and restrict access through integrated multi-factor authentication using biometric mechanisms that are built into Windows 10. Also, enhanced threat resistance and device security. So basically, this means that if you plug in a strange device, it won't, you know, pollute the entire network. So that's another positive thing with Windows 10. Windows Defender, as I've spoke about before, great anti-malware service, and comes with Windows, and it just works because it's, of course, written by Microsoft. And enterprise data protection, which isn't something you podcast listeners are likely interested in, but this is, of course, one of the major reasons that the Department of Defense is also looking at Windows 10. So lots of reasons to upgrade to Windows 10 if you have not already.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, I believe that's it for tech news, unless anyone has anything else.
Not in particular.
Alrighty then. Well, let's talk a bit about the skill of the month here. It is currently the Constitution skill of the month. Sorensen 57 is still in first place with 4.3 million experience gained. Second place is Dave with 3.7 million experience gained. And in third, we still have Pernasius with 3.3 million experience gained with about 2 weeks left in the month, give or take a couple days.
So still anyone's game, really.
It really is in the top three, at least, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even the top five, if you work hard enough. So, going to be interesting to see how this shakes out, because we have had a couple of lead changes over the past week and a bit, but it really looks like Sorensen has solidified a very strong lead over Dave and Parnassius, so we'll have to see what happens over the weekend. And of course, let's not forget we have the double XP weekend coming up in 1 week's time. So
good point. I'm definitely working hard to maintain my stranglehold over last place.
You got it, man. You seem to be dominating. I just
I gotta sew it up.
You got 3,100 XP.
It's not bad.
Hey, it's XP.
Yeah, and I mean, I bet a good chunk of that is from doing the quest too, right?
Just a smidge.
Okay. Alrighty, well, we have one achievement of the week this week, and that is Fast Wesley, who got 99 attack on February 16th. Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. He seems to be getting a lot of 99s lately, so maybe we'll have a maxing at some point. I don't know.
We'll have to wait
maybe
and see.
So, yeah.
Getting a bit ahead of yourself, eh?
Yeah, who knows?
Alrighty. So does anyone have a pick of the week then?
I think maybe. You might, Shane.
Okay, yes.
I might have one.
Yeah, I do indeed have a pick of the week that I can use. Okie dokie. So, I don't suppose anyone here remembers Windows 3.1.
Mm-mm. No.
Not ring any bells.
Okay, well, there's a website hosted at archive.org called the Windows 3.x. Showcase. This is a collection of software that ran on Windows 3.1 in the early 90s, except now it runs in your web browser. So there's a whole lot of them here that you can have a look at and run in your web browsers. And the first one on this list is the Windows 3.11 stock installation. So basically, it downloads a bit of data to your local storage, and then it allows you to run it in your browser. Though apparently we seem to be having a problem running it in Safari right now. Which is unfortunate. Oh, here we go. We're going. We're downloading it clearly. Or quickly, rather. Other things that are available for download aside from the stock system are games like Roulette, Windtrek, Election 92, Wheel of Fortune Ooh. Deluxe Edition.
Wow.
Yeah, so these are
throwbacks.
Brickbuster. So these are actual games that existed back in the day on Windows 3.1.
That's crazy.
Yeah, you guys never used 3.1 then?
I think I just barely remember, like, before my parents upgraded, like, as I was, like, almost an infant.
Okay.
Still having it.
I think this is the first time I've heard of it. Because actually, when I was growing up, I'm a Windows user now, but at the time, our family had a Macintosh, so...
Oh, what happened along the way?
Yeah, you know, I don't remember. We just switched. I mean, it was an old computer, and we ended up just getting a Windows... I think it was 90... No, I don't think it was 98. It was the one after that, like
All right.
XP or something.
So. There's a very early version of Microsoft Paint here, too. It used to be called Paintbrush. You can draw Bezier curves and everything like that that you have come to know in Paint. And of course, you can't save to a file system or print anything, but you do get to experience what it would have been like way back when. So, link for me.
Does it come with bad IT support as well?
Oh, I'm sure it does, because it's just a little... demonstration here, so I mean it's not exactly the snappiest of all things here, so you can see what using Windows was like before the advent of a start menu, believe it or not.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man.
Oh yeah, and there we go. I just painted a background color, so very, very interesting indeed to play around with here. So definitely give this a go if you want to see what things look like in the early 1990s. Oh, there's even one here called Desert Storm, the Air Campaign. Wow, they were sure building lots of games centered around world affairs at the time. I mean, Election 92 and Desert Storm? Wow. There's even a Windows 95 demo. So you could probably spend a good deal amount of time on this website. Yeah, so definitely give it a go.
Yeah.
Archive.org and... I believe it's called the Windows 3.1 Showcase. But link will be in the show notes at update.rsbnb.com.
Check Sweet. It out.
Yep. Alrighty. Well, Oh, I think it just crashed. Anyways, what have you guys been up to this week?
I've just been, I don't know, real life, more school. And then game, did the quest, had fun, good times. And it's been more elite clue scroll grind for me.
Why are you doing that?
Because I'm waiting for the skilling invention stuff to come out, and I want a good reward. My best reward is a frost dragon mask. It was a 600k chest. So, yeah. And I've gotten at least 10 under 100k. So, my luck has to change sometime, right?
Right? Yeah. Maybe? Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah, I'm at chest, I think, 105.
So. You going for the dies?
I mean, that's the goal, but, you know, if I'm going for the die, I'm never going to get the die. If I'm not going for the die, I may happen upon it, so who knows? Who knows?
All right. How about you, Duke?
Just, you know, been playing RuneScape. Just mostly waiting for double XP weekend so I can train my prayer up and get to 95, so... That's kind of a big goal for me. And then getting back into World of Tanks slowly, just a little bit. And, you know, other than that, just relaxing. So.
All righty. As for me this week on RS, still farming Divine Energy. That's still a good way of making money if anyone is at all interested. I think you can really start to make money around level 75 with the Elder Energy. And the Incandescent Energy at level 95 is what I do. So. Give that a go if you're looking for some fast funding. But aside from that, just herb farming, getting ready for double XP weekend, looking for bird's nests, which probably should have been bought a couple weeks ago, but that always happens with me in double XP weekend, making, you know, half potions, that kind of thing. I'm going to be doing lots of herb lore on double XP weekend.
Mm-hmm.
So, also, Colton and I appeared on RS Weekly, which is hosted by MageBit. We had him on the show back in October. We chatted about the quest and a bunch of other things relating to this week's RS news. You can find that on his website at runescape.today once it appears in the feed. Also, we'd like to tremendously thank him once again for having us on the show. It was great fun. That'll be that, I think. Anything else before we go?
Nope.
Sounds like a wrap.
Alrighty. Well, we'll see you next weekend, everyone. Thank you for listening and sharing your time with us. Remember, if you want to chat with us, you can find us at RSBANB on Twitter or in-game our friends chat, Bits Bytes.
See you guys.
Adios.